podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
For organizing this conference, which so far has a big success, I will start my talk with an excursion at CERN, the search of Higgs, and I will continue with discussing from my point of view what can we learn from the standard model physics, beyond standard model, in particular string theory. So string theory is a beautiful theory, but we don't know, because it quantizes essentially gravity, but we don't know if it is realized in the world. And one of the primary questions, trying to connect it to the real world, is what is the value of the string scale, which now we know that it's an arbitrary parameter that can be anywhere between Planck scale and TV. And typically, from physical motivations, one can imagine three possible reasons. High scale related to the unification, intermediate scale related possibly to supersymmetry breaking, strong CP action, seesaw mechanism, and so on. And then low scale as an alternative to supersymmetry for the hierarchy problem. On the other hand, physics beyond the standard model has been driven for many decades, last decades, from the mass hierarchy problem, which we'll know, I guess, by perhaps LHC at some point, if this is the right way of thinking. And the standard pixel is, of course, low energy supersymmetry, which combining all the properties that we want for supersymmetry, I think it's fair to say that the natural string framework is the heterotic string, either in the perturbative or in its non-perturbative versions, like M and F theory. And all of us know the advantage of supersymmetry, starting with introducing natural elementary scalars, gets coupling unification, dark matter candidate, provides a mechanism for a framework for doing a radiative electroweak symmetry breaking, and so on. The main problem is, of course, that it has not been seen, and this introduces already a tension and some degree of fine tuning, which is it's called a little hierarchy problem. Now, going to the excursion at CERN, we saw from the experimental talk that LHC runs very well. It provided already much more luminosity than last year, and the expectations for this year is to get until the end of the year around 25 even femtobands, which when they combined with the last year results could allow to do a lot of physics within and beyond the standard model. And the main highlight is, of course, the discovery of this of a new particle, which is Higgs-like, and it has a mass around 125, 126 GeV. Now, this discovery is first consistent with expectations for the precision test of the standard model. And Gabriele Veneziano showed the first day this curve, which was the analysis from the precision test of LEP and the standard model that were expected already, most likely just from experimental results, that the Higgs should be light. And then I think the main theoretical conclusion is that it favors perturbative physics. The quartic coupling is about 1 over 8, which is something which would be unexpected. Somehow this validates the triumph of quantum field theory, which started with quantum electrodynamics. In the meantime, we had QCD of strong interactions, but QCD finally was shown to be an asymptotically free theory, and this allowed to study also perturbative at high energies. And now we have this Higgs sector, which is the simplest quantum field theory, lambda phi to the 4, with a perturbative coupling that continues this on this trend. If this discovery is confirmed that it is the Higgs of the standard model, then obviously supersymmetry becomes fine-tuned, severely fine-tuned in its minimal version, as Savas discussed already. But it also could be that this points out that the supersymmetry, if it is realized, it is realized in a non-minimal version, for instance, by adding a singlet or by split the two families for the third one, the partners, or by introducing extra U1. This could easily remediate the fine-tuning to acceptable rates. Of course, it is very important to measure the Higgs properties and the Higgs couplings in particular, since any deviation from the couplings that you expect in a standard model to quarks, the top, bottom, and to the Gauge bosons implies presumably new physics, in other words, new light states. And these light states, since they couple to Higgs, they should be involved in the electroweak symmetry breaking, and therefore they will enter this conclusion for the discussion of the fine-tuning problem. At least the preliminary results for the decay rates of the Higgs for me smell like a lot, like besides the fact that there is an uncertainty, that it is very much like the standard model. There is this small deviation in the gamma-gamma, which if it is confirmed, of course, it would be an indication that something is beyond. But for the moment, everything is within the standard model. Of course, there is also the question, what is the quantum numbers of the of the particle? It has to, I guess, to show the parity that it is a scalar, not a pseudoscalar, it will take more time, presumably not this year. The spin probably can be deduced this year. I mean, the difference between, let's say, to exclude the spin 2 possibility. And concerning going beyond the standard model, this was already presented by an experimental colleague that we reach the TV region for the searches for supersymmetry. And in general, for going beyond the standard model, I mean, to other exotics, as they're called, other possibilities, there the TV becomes almost the unit. And okay, there are many exclusions. So one question is, can it be that the standard model is valid at high energies, let's say all the way up to the Planck scale? Then I think it's important to have this indication that take into account the actual value of the top quark and the strong coupling. The quartic coupling of the Higgs seems that it becomes negative at intermediate scales, something like around 10 to the 10, 10 to the 11 GeV. And this doesn't depend a lot on whether if it is between 125 to 126, which could be taken as as an indication that perhaps there is a new physics at this scale. Of course, this, strictly speaking, is not a real instability. It's not a sickness of the theory, because as we saw also from Sava's talk, the potential does not become unstable in the sense it does not become runaway, but simply it's metastable. In other words, there is another minimum. And it could be very well that we live in, our universe lives in a vacuum that is going to be decayed in another vacuum. And if it happens long enough in the future, there is nothing wrong with the theory. Okay, that's a possible constraint, theoretical constraint to impose stability, but it is not a necessity for me. Now, dropping the hierarchy motivation and say, okay, what could it be that the next scale of physics is at the intermediate scales? I don't see anything wrong with that. Dark matter could be an axion. Unification perhaps could be realized in a different way. There have been proposals with such a possibility. What could be the physics at this intermediate scale could be supersymmetry, could be string scale, could be any theory that could make, let's say, the Higgs potential stable if we take this point of view. Of course, if the Higgs scale is tuned, another possibility is the one that discussed by Savas, which is a split supersymmetry, and which is based on the fact that there is R symmetry, and if we under which Gaijinos and Higgsinos transform. So if R symmetry is broken at low energies, while supersymmetry is broken at high energies, then one could imagine a situation in which the Gaijinos and the Higgsinos are light, while the scalars are not. And this has the good properties of supersymmetry maintained, such as gauge coupling unification and the dark matter candidate. It doesn't introduce this flavor problem and so on. Moreover, as we saw, as Saba showed already, the experimentally allowed now region from the Higgs mass, it points, if in the context of this framework, towards a moderate split in which the scale of supersymmetry breaking is a few thousand TeV. Now, in the context of string theory, this can be very easily realized in the context of deep brains, because if their intersections are not supersymmetric, then the scalars are automatically heavy. We can have chiral fermions because of chirality, the index theorems. And moreover, since the deep brains are supersymmetric, the Gaijinos are there to begin massless. And if we want a scalar Higgs which is massless, then the Higgs should be emerged from a supersymmetric intersection together with the Higgsinos, and therefore this automatically realize the basic features of split supersymmetry. On the other hand, okay, now I'll go to an alternative answer is to, we stick on a hierarchy still, and we look at other alternatives, and the possible alternative is low-scale string theory, so string scale at the TeV. The main property here that I think in the past it was not really appreciated is that compared to supersymmetry is that to start with there is no little hierarchy problem. In other words, it becomes better, and the reason is there are no logarithms in the radiative corrections of the Higgs. If the Higgs, let's say, is identified with a scalar, massless scalar coming from a supersymmetric brain intersection, then if the theory is not supersymmetric elsewhere, it will receive radiative corrections, which will be cut off by a string scale times a loop factor. So automatically you have a loop factor that separates the electroweak and the string scale. But as I will show in a moment, this could become even better. The main ingredients for low string scale is that you need large extra dimensions with a volume which is large, 10 to the 32, in the terms of string scale. Such large volumes can in principle be obtained by modulus stabilization, as it has been shown by several groups. The other ingredient is that the string coupling is perturbative. So why not? Everything seems to be perturbative until now, so it could be that the string scale is low and this coupling is perturbative. Let me elaborate a bit on this question on the fine tuning. Suppose that the Higgs arises is a massless at the tree level, either in a supersymmetric intersection or by truncation of some unequal force sector, some supersymmetric sector. If it arises from a truncation of a supersymmetric sector, then the tree-level coupling will be related by the gauge coupling S with supersymmetry. So in some sense, it's like the high-scale supersymmetry is a boundary condition for the Higgs quartic coupling. And then there will be, it will receive radiative corrections, in that case from the annulus diagram. And these corrections can be computed in a toy model, which for simplicity I kept only as a dependence a compactification radius just to show what happens. The sign can be positive or negative, depending on the relative weights of bosons and fermions that are in the, circulating the loop. And then you obtain an integral of this type, where L is the length of the cylinder, infinity is the ultraviolet divergence, and zero is the infrared point. And what is written in red is actually a contribution coming from string, which you cannot find it from string theory by it, starting by the field theory starting from an extra dimension. And what one sees is, of course, that the string factor here suppresses the ultraviolet divergence, while in the infrared it goes to one and it produces the field theory. Now, this integral can be done numerically, and one can show that as a function of the radius, there are two interesting limits. One limit is when the radius goes to zero, then in that case the radius becomes transverse to the brain by t-duality. Just I write it like this for simplicity, and one finds just a loop factor, so this is a number that one expects, which is model dependent, while on the other end, it shows that the string scale becomes an ultraviolet cutoff, while in the other end, when R is large, then what happens is that the string scale drops, it is replaced by the compactification scale, and the coefficient becomes much smaller than this one. The reason for this happening is because in this model, the Higgs scalar is obtained by a component of a higher-dimensional Gates field, and therefore, as you go to higher energies, it is the higher-dimensional Gates invariance which protects the ultraviolet divergences, and it becomes the cutoff of the effective field theory. The coefficient is calculable in the effective field theory, and it turns out to be much smaller. So there is a double suppression here, which is interesting to study. Of course, there are radiative corrections. So if you start with a supersymmetric condition, then one cannot obtain really 125 GeV, and obtains a lower one. But if you relax this condition, then one can easily go to 125. And moreover, the string scale or the compactification scale is naturally a few to several TV. So this could be a possibility. The experimental bounds come from missing energy that was shown just this morning. They vary between 2.5 and 4 TV depending on how many extra dimensions there are. The strongest bound comes from two extra dimensions, the lower for six, which are large, I mean. And then the question is, what are other effects? Black holes are not relevant in this scheme because the string coupling is perturbative and the black hole mass is about 100 times the string scale, so the question is not relevant. And the three other type of signatures that we can imagine is, the first one is the obvious one, which are the string excitations. There was a group here with Dieter who did a lot of analysis of these excitations. I mean, basically, those that are relevant are those which have strong interactions, and therefore the excitations of quark and gluon, so open string excitations. And their main point was that since the string theory is perturbative, the cross sections are model independent, do not depend on the compactification, does not enter in the three-level diagrams. And already, if you saw the present limits from LHC, which have taken this analysis, is already 4.5 TV for the string scale. Now, one could imagine another possibility that the string scale, suppose that it's even higher, and then the question is what could be a signal, another signal which could be manifest at lower energies. One possibility is to have TV extra dimensions, so dimensions which are a bit larger than the string scale, where part of the standard model spectrum can propagate. There are many models here, and the limits vary between a few hundred GeV to 40 GeV, depending on how the fermions, in other words, the quark and leptons, are localized in this extra dimension. The strongest bound come in the case where all the fermions are localized, and therefore the excitations can be produced as resonances. And the lowest bound comes in the universal case in which there are no excitations. In which the fermions are not localized. There is a quantum number, or a parity at least, of the Kaluza-Klein momentum which is conserved. And finally, there is the so that's one possibility. Another possibility is to have U1s, extra U1s, whose masses are obtained by anomalies. So their masses is a loop factor lower than the string scale, and therefore this could be signals of low energy signals of this of such a framework. So this extra, the rest of the time, I will discuss a bit more of these extra U1s, which should gauge global known global symmetries of the standard model, which could be anomalous or not, such as combinations of baryon and lepton number or Petze-Quinn type symmetries. If the U1s acquire masses from anomalies, there are two types of such U1s, U1s which have four-dimensional anomalies, and U1s, which obviously in that case, okay, we know that they had to acquire masses, and U1s which do not have four-dimensional anomalies, but still their masses are not protected because it's related to six-dimensional anomalies, and one has to impose an additional condition if we want to keep them massless, such as the hypercharge. And the generic relation is that such non-anomalous U1s that obtain masses from six-dimensional anomalies are heavier than the four-dimensional ones. So for a concrete model, one can take just a realization, a deep brain realization of the standard model, which contains just two extra U1s. One is the baryon number that accompanies the strong interactions with U3. The other two U1s is the lepton number, the U1 right, which is the embedded from the is a U1 inside the SU2 right, and this model gives precisely the standard model times two extra U1 symmetries, which is a baryon and the lepton number. And there are two possibilities. If the baryon and lepton number acquire anomalies, become massive from anomalies, then they give rise to global symmetries, which is the baryon and lepton number symmetry, and which are welcome because if the string scale is low, then the lepton number, for instance, is needed to protect light, to protect neutrino masses from the Weinberg operator. That baryon number, of course, for proton decay. Also, in that case, one could imagine that since the B minus L is anomaly free, and its mass is heavier than the baryon, the lowest, the lightest U1 should be the one which couples mostly to quarks. And this could lead to signals which are of the leptophobic types. And at some point, CDF, actually still, it has such events. And there's still debate whether these are there or not. Another possibility is that B minus L or a combination, anomaly free combination of B minus L and the hypercharge remains massless all the way down, it remains massless, in which case it would be interesting to take the same model and just increase the string scale. So in some sense, you go to you study just a variation of the standard model with an extra U1, in which case one can show that one needs some extra Higgs which has the quantum numbers of the I neutrino in order to break the B minus L. This along the lepton variation, along the lepton direction. Now, since the lepton number violation occurs only in these models just by simple analysis from higher dimensional operators, which are suppressed by the string scale, then this is okay. And furthermore, by imposing the baryon number to be a global symmetry, then essentially one obtains a condition where the gauge coupling of this additional Z double prime, this additional U1, is almost fixed. And the present limits from LHC is about 2.5 TeV. This model has interest in phenomenology and cosmology. And the basic property is that in order to make the B minus L anomaly free, one needs to introduce three right hadron neutrinos. And it turns out that there are, the B minus L is broken at relatively low energies, then these three right hadron neutrinos could lead to effects in cosmology. And there are already indications that there is the so-called dark radiation, which is, can be parametrized by effective neutrino number, which is close to 4, like a sterile neutrino. So if one can fit this number with the three right-hand neutrinos that we have here, and impose and this will impose a bound on the mass of the extra U1, which is within the LHC reach. So that's possibility. Another thing that one can do is one can study, just to finish the stability of the Higgs potential in this model. So we can write the most general Higgs potential with its parameters. And then one can, in contrast to the standard model, with this extra U1, one can show that there are regions in which the stability is possible. And for instance, these are the regions of stability which constrain the mass of the extra Higgs and a mixing parameter between the two Higgses, between the standard model Higgs and the extra Higgs. Which I call alpha. So one can see that as the string scale becomes higher and higher, the upper limit for the mass of the Higgs goes down. And all this region is in principle can be explored in LHC. And this is a similar curve. If we fix the string scale and vary the Z double, the extra Z prime mass. So that's conclusions. I think the first is that the possible confirmation of the discovery of LHC, of the Higgs scalar at LHC is a big step forward. It's of primary importance, of course, to study, to measure its couplings, which hopefully it will happen this year. And we hope from this to get a hint of the origin of mass hierarchy. And some of the question is whether supersymmetry is realized in a natural way. Well, if not, if for instance string scale is low in some realization, or there is something else. And hopefully there is good chance that in the next round of LHC we'll have the answer. Thank you.